So we've got three spectacular panelists for you today. First, I'm pleased to introduce Rob Van Wielengen. Rob is the president and CEO of Viewpoint Investment Partners Corporation, which is a branch from the private family-owned business Viewpoint Group. Rob has deep systematic knowledge about financial markets, economics, technology, and family businesses. He's a CFA charter holder and a registered portfolio manager across Canada. Now, Rob leads Viewpoint's team of investment professionals, data scientists, and software engineers. So he's seen what goes into the inside of a data science-driven fintech company. And his firm manages over $400 million of assets across four quant strategies offered by the company. Rob and his father, Mac, were founding partners of the Creative Destruction Labs, and Rob has grown and led Viewpoint's angel investment portfolio since 2010. So just a quick thank you to Rob for being here. Next, we've got Danielle Gifford. I actually never knew how to pronounce your last name, Gifford or Gifford?
Gifford. Like Clifford.
Gifford like Clifford. All right, we've got Danielle Gifford like Clifford. Since the beginning of her career, Danielle has worked in and with startups in B2B and B2C technologies in AI, AR, augmented reality, and cloud platforms from pre-seed all the way through to Series B. Formerly, she was with Creative Destruction Labs and AltaML, and she's got experience in building and leading global and technical teams delivering AI products in digital media, finance, renewables, supply chain, and marketing. Wide breadth. Today, Danielle is the executive director of Movement51, the education platform for the investment company, The 51, that provides programming across Canada for women and gender-diverse early-stage investors and founders looking to acquire tools, practical skills, and build their community for investing and raising capital. Just quick thanks to Danielle for being here. And finally, we've got Rick Bird. Rick Bird is the CEO of Thin Air Labs, and he's a general partner at Thin Air Labs Fund 1, where they are igniting venture growth for greater human impact. Rick is a multi-time startup operator with more than 15 years of experience developing tech organizations from early stage through to exit. Rick has been a part of two Canadian exits, where he built and scaled operations, customer success, sales, and risk management teams. Rick has also been an advisor to multiple early stage companies, helping to raise capital, develop product market fit, business models, metrics, and leadership teams. Rick is passionate about sharing his experience and expertise with the Calgary innovation ecosystem. And in case anybody's not aware, Thin Air Labs is the first Alberta VC studio. Is that correct?
We'll go with it.
All right, well, yeah, thanks to Rick for being here. So the question that I'd like to start off with here today is, you know, as I said in the opening for this, that there's probably a lot of people here who, in this audience, who have been thinking about starting a company, might want to eventually, or at least played with the idea. And so what I wanted to ask this panel of investors is, what are some of the attributes of a great founder of a tech company?
I'll go first on that one. Because this one to me is actually probably the best question of the whole bunch. And my answer to this would be the greatest attribute you can have is sales. And when I say sales, I don't mean selling your product. I mean high emotional intelligence, high EQ. And when you're a founder, you are selling your investors on your company, you're raising money, you're selling yourself and your vision to your team. You're selling your company every single interaction in your entire life. So that having that high EQ, and it's really, really hard to learn and teach, which makes it extra challenging. I mean, the technical side is obviously very, very important, but when we're looking at companies and opportunities, that's always something that we're looking for is, can this founder tell a story and hook me, whether I'm a customer or an investor or an engineer? I would say that's the number one attribute that comes to my mind.
Yeah, I would say building on that too is the founder market fit, so almost like product market fit, but for yourselves. And so, you know, if you've been in a company, I mean, we've all experienced problems in companies, but if you've been in a company and you experience a problem and then you actually go out and you try and solve that problem, so you're familiar with the industry, you're familiar with the tools, the technologies, the different business units, the different business stakeholders. And so I think that founder market fit is really important. I would also say having the vision, like Rob was saying, like having that vision, having the passion, having the grit. Being a founder is incredibly difficult. It's a lot and it takes a lot of perseverance. And so having the humility to like know when you're wrong, but then also having the grit to continue on in those hard times.
So for me, I think all those are really exceptional points. The main experience is so incredibly important. And as Danielle was mentioning, when you're working in an industry, you are exposed to really exceptional problems in that industry. And through that, there should come a time where you're able to use your experience influencing others to help folks understand that there's a problem that you've discovered in your industry. The problem is getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and you are in a unique position to solve that problem. So domain experience is really key. And then the other two factors that I'd mention as it relates to really high quality founders, one, infinite curiosity, so a learning mindset. There's very little that you know today that you'll be using 3 or 5 years from now as you go from stage to stage to stage. So that ability to embrace learning and embrace the failures along the way that are so often associated with learning. And then finally, the ability to attract and inspire really exceptional talent, whether that's talent right here in the city of Calgary or talent that will move to the city of Calgary because they believe in your vision. And then activating that talent and helping them be the arms and legs of your organization as you begin to scale.
Awesome. Yeah, so I actually think that, you know, that's really, really great perspective. And we kind of heard from what you guys are looking for with a founder, but what about for the actual firm itself? Maybe talk me through the due diligence process, and especially how you're looking through the due diligence process for a, you know, tech company that might have aspirations or plan to leverage artificial intelligence, data science, data engineering.
Yeah, maybe I can kickstart this one. So obviously, business model is really important and how are you actually going to generate revenue. But I would say when we're going through the due diligence process, when we're looking at companies, and just due diligence might be like a jargon term for people. It's like, let's take a peek underneath the hood and see what's going on inside this company. So it's looking at the team, the product market fit, the technologies, the forecast of revenues. And so what I would say we look at specifically is the data, the model, and the people when we're looking at technical companies. And so data in the sense of, do you actually have a data moat? So is there something really unique to the data that you're like that you've acquired or the data that you're working with? Is it a proprietary data set? So what we're seeing a lot of times, like everyone's familiar with ChatGPT and DALL-E, which is great, and these different types of open source models. But there's a lot of companies that are being built off open source models, which is okay, but what if all of a sudden you don't have access to that open source model? And so now you no longer have that technical capability inside your business. The other thing too is around people and really understanding if the team has the core competencies both in the domain and on the technical side. And so when you're looking at technical companies, I would say it's really important to have a technical founder because it's really crucial. So like if you're building out, you know, even if it's like software engineering and you have, you know, two business co-founders, how do you understand what's going on under the hood? How are you asking the right questions? How do you know if you're building models at the production ready scale that they need to be built at? And I would say even on the technical side, there's a big difference between like building things through kind of like an academic and like a research lens, but then also building things through like a business and a commercial lens. And those are two things that are really important because like we know the data when it comes to like building models and production environments, and you know, 90% of models are failing to get into production. So those are some things that I think are really key, is just kind of looking at the people, the data, and the model.
we mostly follow people that are smarter than us into deals. And, you know, for us, the domain expertise, we're generalists. And one of the challenging things about being an investor in this space is it's very technical. There's 100 industries. And so a startup will get placed into an industry in which we don't have that expertise. And so one question that I always ask our team is, how hard is it for this company to sell their product? And or service, whatever it is, whatever problem they're trying to solve, there's a problem, there's a solution, they have an idea to solve this problem. 100 other people have had the same idea. And so they've created a solution to this, and it's about execution. How hard is it to sell? Are they gonna have to grind for every single sale, or is it really obvious? And the companies that are able to scale, to really scale, which is ultimately the goal, it's really obvious that the solution, like it's product market fit, but that it's not, the sale isn't difficult, it's the implementation of the solution that's difficult, if that makes any kind of sense at all.
One of the things that we look for, and we invest in the very earliest stages, in some cases where there's not a single line of code written or a website and so on, we look for a founder who has been able to surround themselves with potential customers for the future. And when we talk to them, and they're not using the product today necessarily, or maybe they're using the prototype and they're getting some value out of it, they're probably not paying for it. But when we talk to them, they all say, the very first thing that I think about when I wake up out of bed in the morning is this problem that this current founder is solving for. As opposed to, the problem that this solves for me would be really nice to solve, but it's the fifth or sixth thing on my list. And to Rob's point, those are some of the things that are really important as it relates to a venture in the early days, being able to gain the sales traction that they would like so that they can reach the next stage of growth.
Awesome. Yeah, there's some really interesting topics in here. I actually want to dig a little bit more into what you were talking about, Danielle, on a data moat. Because I imagine, especially for many, as you're saying, like for early stage companies, you know, the establishment of a proprietary data set might be quite challenging, or sinking multiple years of research into developing an AI model might not be feasible for many startups. So, you know, I imagine there's probably some type of scale in terms of like a roadmap to develop some kind of data moat. And I think that ties in quite well with the idea of data strategy. And so maybe we can speak a little bit as a group here towards the importance of developing a data strategy as a early stage tech firm, how that might lead towards the establishment of a data moat and what ultimately could be IP that you can then go on to monetize.
So from a data moat perspective, in the very early days of your startup's ideation and creation, you don't really have any data, right? And you need to simultaneously share this vision of eventually becoming the steward of highly curated data that no one else has and that everyone needs, but today you're not quite there yet. And one of the reasons why companies that have a moat around their data are so incredibly powerful and valuable is because more often than not, if you have really exceptional data that is fueling your existing product, there are probably customers and customers of customers or partners who can get a ton of value from that data that you have once it's trusted. And so there are second products and third products, or first industries and second industries and so on, that you can find your way down the path to when you have a really exceptional data set. One of the tricks, though, is ensuring that you're investing your time and energy of your team really effectively in the early days. So you can't build, in most cases, a really exceptional data platform that is scalable to millions of users and so on, you need to start with something, more often than not, that is somewhat human powered. And then over time, it becomes algorithmically powered. And then over time, eventually, you invest more heavily with something that is AI or machine learning powered and so on. And it's about getting those investments right in alongside the velocity change of the customer growth and team growth in your organization.
So Rick, let me get this straight. It sounds like you're saying that the first step for a new startup isn't actually to build an AI model to automate everything. You've got things, you're using language like human powered and algorithmically powered. So maybe we can elaborate on that a little bit. And you know, if step one isn't, you know, AI to power everything, when is the right time for a startup to start incorporating, you know, AI or data science into their business?
Yeah, I would say on that, it's really trying to figure out what is the problem that you're trying to solve or what is that solution, and really kind of having that focus, right? Because you can use, at this point, AI on a lot of different areas of the business, different products, different features, depending on what you are doing. But really, where is that key value coming from, and what is that key value that your customers are looking for? And so really just trying to understand, like, what are you trying to predict? Are you trying to predict an outcome? Are you trying to predict a theme? Are you trying to predict a classification or a category? Like, what is that prediction and what does that specifically look like? Because we see a lot of the times, and like even speaking from experience working with larger companies, more in the enterprise side, they just want to apply AI to everything. They're like, we're going to use AI to fix this. I know what the solution is. It's AI. It's like that's not the right solution because you don't even really know what the problem that it is you're trying to solve. And it's really kind of taking a step back and looking at the problem from multiple different angles. Because like oftentimes what we see, and this is again, I'm like using my enterprise hat, but we see like the problem that like the C-suite might want to solve is much different than the problem that the end user actually needs. So who is that end user and what is the tool, the product, the feature that they need that's going to enhance their workflow to better serve their customers or to better kind of create products? And it's really kind of taking a couple steps back. It's like I've seen multiple times like going in and building things where it's like it just doesn't have that value. And then who are you really building that for? And so really coming back to that, and we used to use this kind of concept at AltML, which is like the machine learning canvas. So it's this idea of the business model canvas, but it's a machine learning canvas, and it's a single page, and it's very simple. But it's simple to the fact that it gets everyone on that same page of like, what is the value proposition? What is the problem we're solving? What is the data set? And what is that end use? Because like at the end, you'll often kind of come to this thing where it's like, you know, the business is building or asking for things that the analytics team can't do, and the analytics team is building things that aren't useful for the business. So it's kind of taking a couple steps back to that. Because if you go in and you're like, we're just going to use AI, sprinkle AI dust on everything, it just doesn't work, and like, it is expensive. And then you also end up with a lot of technical debt. And no one likes technical debt.
I would just add to that, that investors have gotten more sophisticated in sniffing out what AI is and why it's being used. And so everyone's coming into offices saying we're using AI. And we're at this place now where we've come to the conclusion, generally, this is really building what Danielle's saying, that your edge doesn't have to be AI. And oftentimes, the best use of AI or ML in a startup is in enhancing and enhancing your edge, which is, but your core edge is more like, you know, what Danielle's saying, which is you're solving this problem. You don't necessarily need AI to solve it, but can you use AI around the edges to enhance what your edge is? And walking into a VC's office or an angel office and saying, well, we're using AI, like our edge is AI, like, the BS detectors start going off right away. There are certain cases where that is true, where you have huge data sets, like in drug development or in health and medicine primarily, where the pattern recognition and outcome prediction of AI is the edge. but it's very rare. So I just wanted to add that to your comments.
Yeah, maybe let's, I like this idea, especially, you know, as we're thinking from what going through an investor's mind as they're going through, you mentioned like the BS detector. I'm wondering if there's any examples that this group could share of times, you know, whether real or hypothetical, of, you know, someone's pitching you and what maybe some warning signs that either they're using, that sets off maybe that BS detector, whether they're not ready to use the technology or they think it can do something that it can't.
I think a lot of times when folks are coming in and pitching their venture, and I'm sure there are folks in this room who have pitched before. I have. It's extremely difficult and one of the most challenging things you'll ever do. But there's instantaneous feedback, and it can be very helpful from a growth perspective. Most times when folks are coming in and they're talking about AI ML and how that is the core of why you should invest, it's not for bad intentions. There's just a mismatch of understanding at that stage that it's not actually AI ML that most customers, as Rob said, most customers in the world are actually buying for. They're buying for the problem that they think about when they first wake up out of bed in the morning. And that's what you want your founder to be talking about, typically. And the subset of that, some of the how of that, might have an AI component here or there, which is a part of the vision of the organization's future.
Yeah, I would say like AI, I mean, unless you're like OpenAI, it's never gonna be your core competency or your core capability. It's just something to enhance the problem that you're solving for the business. And I think that's like what the focus is it's using that enhancement around like these different edge cases and going through. And I would say, just kind of echoing Rick's point, and I've pitched too, it's like, it's incredibly daunting, right? Because if you're kind of out there and you're selling your soul, you're showing your baby to the world and you're hoping they don't call it ugly. And so it's hard. And so with founders, it's just kind of like, when you're coming in and if you are pitching, it's like really knowing and understanding your business, knowing that you don't always have to like jump right into like the jargon. And so like, we used to do this kind of like, you know, talk to your mom about like your business problem, or like explain random forest to your mom. And it sounds really silly, but it's just like, if you can explain it at that certain level so that they understand, and using kind of that same approach when you're coming in potentially to a VC's office or you're pitching your business, because it's like a lot of the times we can use these different terminologies that people don't necessarily understand. So like here it's like pre-seed, seed, ARR, MRR, IRR. And like when you're working with machine learning and artificial intelligence, it's like unsupervised, supervised, random forest. And so just like really kind of breaking it down so that it's a common language that everyone understands. Because I think that's really helpful in kind of going through. Because it's easy when you like are going in there and like you're kind of, I'm gonna use all this fancy terminology and they're really gonna get it. But like as Rob was saying, like a lot of the times in venture, like you're not a domain expert. Like unless you're a specific ventures capital studio, like real ventures, where it's like we just specifically focus on AI, and like our investment thesis, which is basically what their focus is on, is in artificial intelligence, machine learning. A lot of people don't have that domain knowledge. So really kind of coming in at that ground level of understanding, I think can be helpful for founders.
Awesome. Yeah, no, great. Let's have a little pivot. I mean, we've kind of talked a lot about the actual science process in the investing world, but let's get local here and let's kind of start talking about Calgary. Maybe let's have a little conversation about Calgary specifically, and I think I'll open it up with, you know, just tell me about the Calgary ecosystem. Like, what sorts of strategic advantages does Calgary have, and what does it offer to, you know, these early stage companies and to growing tech companies, like when,
We had a great conversation about this before this panel. So Calgary is fantastic. It's an amazing city, amazing province. Like I'm in Alberta, I'm Calgary born. And we have a super educated, highly trained workforce with a focus in STEM, who also had nothing to do from 2014 to 2019 or 2020. And we have an amazing lifestyle here, which are all fantastic things. But there's, this is my personal opinion, there's really nothing special about Calgary in the context of strategic advantages for startups. And, you know, if you look at it and move around the world and go to any major city, you're going to find tech incubators, you're going to find Platform Denver, not to be disparaging about Platform Calgary by any means, but you're going to find a burgeoning tech ecosystem that's competing, trying to compete globally. And, you know, we want that here, but we're competing with London and Boston and the Valley and Tel Aviv. And so I think, like, aside from the qualities that I mentioned at the beginning, which is a highly trained workforce, really safe, great infrastructure, great lifestyle, affordability, like the actual city, like that's great to, for any industry to work in. I don't actually feel like there's anything particularly special about Calgary, except the only thing I would say is that I think that our health and medicine tech ecosystem here, we should be out there pumping this up to the whole world. And for layman's, or for people who don't know Calgary, that's something that we can, that we're super strong in. I think we should emphasize more.
And here I thought that you were going to say the thing that really differentiates Calgary is the YYC data economy. yeah, Rick, it looks like you got some thoughts on this topic as well, differentiation of Calgary.
Sure.
In response to Rob as well.
Well, I think it's an interesting point that Rob made around strategic advantages, and Rob's right. There are accelerators in every major city. There is access to capital in every major city, and on and on and on, right? So what's special or what's different about Calgary? And maybe that's not so much the question here, in my mind anyway. I think Calgary has exceptional founders, and some of those folks might be in this room right now, or they're going to become exceptional founders. And one of the reasons why founders are so exceptional in Calgary is not because of strategic advantages, but because of the disadvantages, because of how hard it has been to raise capital here, how access to talent has been challenging, and how selling into customers in your backyard may not be so easy as it is in New York or Toronto or somewhere else with a higher population and more folks that are tech-enabled and buy early-stage tech. And as a consequence of that, I think, from what I've seen personally, founders in Calgary tend to build their companies with a global mindset just a little bit sooner. And capability of those folks who have had engineering careers is exceptional. And I see each and every day a lot of folks that have been in that world transitioning into product or UI, data science, and so on and so forth, with extreme ease, actually, in a lot of cases, because there are so many parallels between those worlds in terms of how you execute. And I think that's exceptional for the city of Calgary and certainly Alberta, and highly helpful to the ventures who need them.
Yeah, kind of building on that point, I would say one thing that's unique, not necessarily just about Calgary, but with Alberta, is so the Alberta Enterprise Corporation, and so it's called AEC. And so essentially what it is it's a fund of funds. And so if you think about all these different venture capital funds, Alberta Enterprise Corporation is basically a fund that's like built out by the government and by some other different kind of limited partners that allows it to kind of fuel other venture capital funds and kind of start them up and give them some capital. That then kind of has this trickle-down effect that allows them to invest in startup companies. And so this kind of fund-to-fund model that was started really kind of helped fuel a lot of the venture capital firms that were here in Calgary, like especially if you've ever heard of Panache Ventures, they invest in like a lot of pre-seed and seed companies like across Canada, they were really kind of helped get them started when they did their first initial fund, and now they've raised another like $100 million fund, I think. And so I think that's something that's really unique in terms of that access to capital. I think something also, and like Rob was saying, like might not necessarily be special, but just like the community here and like the platforms and the accelerators and like the different people in the community that are also willing to help. And so like I grew up in Toronto, moved all around there, it was like fun, but came out to Calgary about 6 years ago, and the ecosystem here is much different. Like it's not like dog eat dog and like no one's willing to help each other. Like people are willing to help here and to connect you and to connect you into customers, connect you into potential talent sources. And that's something I find really unique here compared to other ecosystems that I've worked in, is there's just kind of this like, hey, we're in it together and like, let's help each other build. And so I think that's something that makes Calgary special, at least in my eyes.
Yeah, and actually as we were conversing before we got up on stage, Danielle, you were using an example around from Tel Aviv and boxes and all of that. I actually thought that was quite interesting. Maybe you could just share it again with the group, and then, you know, that is maybe something that's different about the ecosystem, the mindset here in Alberta, and I'd be also interested to hear Rick and Rob's perspectives on that.
Yeah, and so essentially what it is this idea of going global from day one. And so and part of like my career, one of the opportunities I had was to go to Israel. And so if you're not familiar with Israel, they're a startup nation. They have the density of founders and companies that are unicorns per capita. And so a unicorn is a $100 million company, is immense compared to any other industry or kind of geography that's out there. And so what one of the professors was explaining to me is if you take a look at Canada, the US, and Israel, and just kind of put it into this idea of a box. And so if you take Canadians, and we all know this to be true, and like you draw a box, you know, Canadians are most likely to kind of stay inside this box. We might go to the edges and kind of see, oh, cool, what's going around in there, but we'll generally stay in. And then if you draw a box with Americans, our friends a little south of the border, they want to break through the box, right? They're like, hey, I don't like this, I'm confined, like I need to get out of here. But then if you think about Israel, there is no box. It's like that growth mindset, it's failing fast, and it's kind of this cultural appreciation that like, it's okay to fail and things are gonna happen. And like, we found this very much when I was working at one of the startup companies and we were building augmented reality for the furniture industry. We could not sell here. Like, we actually did no sales here. We tried very hard to like sell in Toronto and found we always had to go south of the border to make our sales. And so that was something that was really unique, just kind of on like what your point, Rick, was like, we're not necessarily early adopters. I think we're trying to be, but that early adoption mentality and like that risk tolerance to fail and being okay with failure and accepting failure. Because I mean, failing like sucks, but it happens and you just pick yourself back up.
Yeah, and the perspective that I'd really like to hear is, I'll pose the question, is like almost a binary decision, right? Like, do you think that we should change that mindset and try and embrace more of the American, the Tel Aviv, Israeli mindset, or do you think that we recognize that that's something that's different about the local ecosystem or investing in Canada and actually work within that mindset?
I mean, I think we should change it, yeah. And have a global mentality, a scale mentality, a scale up mentality from the very beginning, but it's easier said than done. And, you know, the other thing I would add is we're talking about sales and growth, but also on the fundraising side, like, we get feedback, and I'm sure you guys do too, all the time about how hard it is to raise capital. And Rick referred to it, how hard it is to raise capital in the box. That is in Canada, but in Calgary, especially in Western Canada, so on that side is especially difficult. But yeah, I do think we need to have more of a Tel Aviv type mentality.
Anything to add? Last maybe Calgary focused question. I'd like to hear if anybody would like to share from one of the local Calgary companies that you've seen rise in the past decade or so that are really leaders in the early stage tech, especially if it relates to data science, and maybe share a little bit about what makes them special or what's very inspiring about that company.
Okay, so I'm going to share the company, but I'm going to let Rick explain it since it's in the portfolio. But there's a great company in town called Stellar Algo. If you haven't heard about it, you should definitely look it up. They are a rocket ship, and if you get the opportunity to join them, I would strap in immediately. but Rick, I'll get you to pitch them.
Awesome. So, as Danielle mentioned, Stellar Auto is an amazing company, and they are in the business of helping sports leagues identify with and connect more strongly with their fans. And if you enjoy any sport, you might know that sports fans are actually the highest lifetime value, the most retained, or some of the most retained folks on the planet in any business and so on. And Stellar Algo is a company that, for the very first time, has enabled sports teams like the NHL or the NBA to not only identify and connect more deeply with their customer bases, but to help their advertisers understand how that's happening. So, for example, if you think about Toronto, there's the ACC Center, or I think now the Scotiabank Center, and Stellar Algo can help a company like Scotiabank that has sponsored that, that spot understand how many of those fans have actually come in and engaged with Scotiabank products in some way. And this is super, super important in the advertising industry. And sponsorship is incredibly important to sports teams. One of the really special things about Stellar Algo is at the beginning of their growth, they were a couple of years in, they had maybe 40, 50 customers, and a lot of those customers were small, like minor league teams and so on. COVID happened, and you could not go to an event if you wanted to. Everything was shut down. But the work that they were doing with those customers was so impactful that they lost almost none of them. It was so engaging. And when everything came back and you were allowed to sit in stadiums again and so on, all those customers came back with high trust and they went even deeper into partnership with that company, which led to the most recent investment in Stellar Algo, which was actually the NBA, so exceptional company.
Yeah, and even thinking about, so like if you're Scotiabank and you just bought like the naming rights to the ACC, which is probably like, I don't know, tens of millions of dollars, it's a pretty big investment. And so if you've made that investment, one of the things you're probably waking up with is like, how am I capturing that return and what does that look like? And so like it's a great example of like a problem that's on people's minds, especially when it comes to sponsorships.
Awesome. Well, I've got a lot more questions that I can ask, but I also really want to make sure that we get the audience a chance to get engaged, and especially as this is, you know, there's not many opportunities that you get to ask questions of the investors. So if anybody has a question they'd like to ask for the panel, for an individual member, yeah, let's get some mics going on. I'll just give you mine for now.
Hello. How you guys doing?
Great.
You guys look like Shark Tank. Three of you.
We were waiting for the green beer, Ben's green beer for St. Patrick's Day.
So, you know, let's say I'm somebody who has a great idea, some sort of business model, and you know, I want to come sell it to you guys. How do I do that?
So I would say first thing I would do is really understand. So kind of like when Rob was talking about sales. If you're going to an investor, every single investor has what's called an investment thesis. And so an investment thesis is essentially their like ideal customer profile of what they're looking for to invest in. And so there's different types of industries. So if it's real ventures, it might specifically be focused on AI. There could be venture capitalists that are specifically focused on healthcare. And so really kind of doing your due diligence on the investors of what do they invest in? What stage are they willing to invest if it's like pre-seed or like maybe you just have an idea and they're willing to invest in the founder? Do they need to see some traction? And then also kind of doing your due diligence on what types of companies have they invested in and what does that look like? And so there's a great resource that you can use called Crunchbase, and it's free, and you can actually kind of research all of the different venture capital firms and kind of see what they've invested in. But then I would also have a really well thought out kind of pitch deck. Like, what are you selling? What is the problem that you're solving? What's your solution? What's your business model? You don't have to have it all figured out yet, but just kind of thinking through those things. And like, what's your target market? And like, when you're thinking from raising from a venture capitalist, venture capitalists are investing other people's money, so they need to see a big return, and it's often that 100x. And so are you solving a problem that's big enough in terms of the market, in terms of that return? And then also kind of looking at the team, like who's on your team and why are you the right team to solve this problem? There's also tons of great resources out there that you can leverage as well.
Thanks.
Well, do you mean how to prepare your pitch to be attractive, or do you mean how to access the resources to find groups that would fund you?
Number two. Well, I'm pretty sure there's people here in this room as well who probably have some sort of idea or
something
groundbreaking, and they have no idea how to go about getting into a room with one of you guys.
So I think that with Danielle, the last point Danielle made, which was there's organizations like Platform Calgary, the university, like Creative Destruction Labs, a number of organizations like that that you can literally go in and say, listen, I have this idea. It might be a good idea or it might be a bad idea, but I have an idea. How do I go about like evaluating whether it's a good idea or not, and how to go about the whole process that Danielle's describing? Connect in with some of those groups, and I don't know if there'd be a list, like maybe YYC Data could provide a list of those types of organizations.
Well, even like type in ChatGPT, like, list of firms that finance in Calgary, seriously, and it'll provide you. I use ChatGPT all the time, but like even do that and just kind of find that. And like the one thing I'll say to you is like when you're connecting in with ventures or provincial or potentially like capital providers is like it's like a first impression, right? So you want to kind of make sure you have your stuff together in terms of like what you're going to be pitching, what does it look like. It is a long process, like you don't just like walk in and get funded, like it can take months or even years. And so that part is definitely a sales part as well. But there's lots of great ecosystem partners, and there's lots of great people in the community that you can connect with.
Thank you.
Any other questions for the panel?
Yeah.
You can just send that mic around. I don't need to talk.
Hi, I have a question about if you have a bit of hardware involved in your idea or product, some form of IoT-based artificial intelligence or ML-based product, does that become a friction issue because there's hardware involved?
Hardware has been out of favor for a long time. I don't have, like, if you say the word hardware, yes, it's like an immediate, like, oh, it's hardware. And so, you know, and you're seeing hardware providers desperately trying to become SaaS-based. And there's a lot of examples of that. Like, Whoop is a great example of that. But there is friction there. Yeah, I don't know.
So our fund is a generalist fund, which means we will invest anywhere, with the exception for us of oil and gas, because we're just simply not the experts there. But to echo Rob's point, what I would touch on there is when you're not the expert, particularly for a hardware business, it can be extremely difficult to know if you're making the right decision. And you need to rely on the expertise maybe of another venture fund or entity that is leading, putting the biggest check in and doing the majority of the due diligence on that given piece of hardware when you're not the expert. And so I would say today it is more difficult to raise early stage venture capital on hardware plays than it is, say, for AI, ML, database-based software plays.
And one additional piece of context that I'll share with you, you know, there are, as you know, the experts have said, there's probably some challenges. There is a group in Calgary called Alberta IoT, and they could be a good resource if you are looking into the IoT space to help to connect investors and partnerships with companies in the IoT space. And so that could be another avenue that you could explore. I'm not affiliated with them, I don't know very much about them, but they are funded by Alberta Innovates as well. And so there could be some opportunities where, you know, going through that, those industry experts could actually offer a path through some of that friction.
Great talk, first of all. How do you place a value on the data moat that you were talking about? And if I have data that only four or five other parties around the world have, why would I raise in Calgary? Why not go to the US where there can be a higher valuation? So just like, there are two parts of that question, but would love to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, so on the second part of that question, you can go wherever you want to raise capital. And like, I definitely would explore avenues. And like, if you are looking to raise capital, know that like when you are raising potentially from like a firm, like it's usually like a 10-year cycle. So like whoever you're raising from, like you're with them for 10 years. So you want to make sure that it is also a good partner as well. So, but I also wouldn't also go solely off of like valuation. So like, I think that there's this weird hype cycle and FOMO with like valuations right now, and like we've seen a lot where it's like it needs to be a $100 million company, but like really, what is the value that you are providing back to your customers? And sometimes those valuations were coming off companies that weren't even profitable, right? And so don't solely go based off of like where you're going to get the highest valuation. I would also go for who could be a strategic partner, and like kind of Rick was saying, like you don't touch this certain area because we're not a domain expert. And so those are some kind of different things that I would look at. Not sure if anyone wants to take the data vote,
part of it. I mean, that it's a really hard question to answer because I think it really depends on the industry, it depends what kind of data you're talking about. I don't know how to answer that, actually.
Good. So it's hard to get money, but say I can, how do I choose a person to date, right? How do you choose the person to take money from? What's something we should look for in an investor?
I would look at the companies that they've already invested in, and like, don't be afraid to talk to them, right? It's almost like reference checking companies of like, have you had a good experience with them? What has it been like? Crunchbase, again, like is another great resource that you can use for that. And then just continuing to have conversations with them. Cause like it is, you're usually in there for the long haul, depending on like how well the company is doing. Something I might suggest.
Yeah, your ability to choose the right investors for you will only improve over time. You won't always get it right, but eventually you'll become really performant with it. And that just takes effort and learning through transactions, right? Actually having those interactions. I think what's most important in your question there is for every founder, for every person who's starting a business, the answer to that question is different. In terms of criteria, what's super important is that the investor that is entering into that 10-year partnership with you is someone that you could see yourself working with for 10 years, and someone that fits your unique criteria for what will make you comfortable that they're a partner with you and they're going with you on that journey.
And can they help you? I mean, that's kind of the unsaid thing here is you want, I mean, if you have this great business and you have your choice of investors, and which investor can help you grow? Like as a strategic, they have connections in that specific industry. You know, we talk about tech a lot, but it's every industry is a tech industry now. So do they have expertise in the industry you're in that they can help connect you with customers, with advisors, with other peers and competitors? That's a really important point. And valuation, actually, you know, to that Danielle's point, or I can't remember if it's Rick or Danielle, should actually, in my view, come a little bit further down the list than it's given credence for. And the importance of having a strategic investor that you like personally working with is as or more important.
Yeah, I was actually hoping you talk about the valuation and when to go about or how important to do the valuation. I feel like that's probably an area that's quite a mystical art for a lot of people, whether they're founders or investors. You know, maybe you guys could share a little bit of perspective and insight on the art of the valuation.
Yeah, I mean, at the seed, pre-seed, friends and family rounds, I guess probably in the audience there's some differing knowledge of how this kind of works, but the whole concept is you have an idea, you're gonna get it, you wanna get it funded, you go raise money from your friends and your family, and you don't put a valuation on your company because it's impossible to value. And same at the next stage, the seed stage or pre-seed. And the Series A stage is really, and feel free to jump in and correct me anytime, is really where you're looking to place a valuation on your company from a professional investor, where you actually have revenue, at least. You're not going to be profitable in all likelihood, but you have revenue that you can assign a multiple to. So the thing about valuation, it's all about comparables. And so what have similar companies to you been financed at in the past is the main kind of metric. Now it's not really an art, well maybe it is an art, I don't know, an imprecise kind of process.
Yeah.
A little bit like throwing darts. but you don't have to value your company until you get to a stage where you have meaningful revenue through a mechanism that's known as a safe note, or it's a piece of paper that lets your early investors convert to equity at a later price. And it's really simple. It's pretty much the standard in the industry.
I'll just echo that in the earliest stages, the importance of valuation is not extreme. So talk to other founders. Talk to founders that are in your industry. Ask them, especially those who have recently gone through an exercise, maybe in the last 6 months, ask them about their experiences and what worked and what didn't work and so on. Good venture capital firms won't tend to spend a whole lot of time on valuation, and you shouldn't either, until both parties have mutually agreed that this is something they're both very interested in and want to form a long-term relationship. The safe note that Rob mentioned, it's just a way for both the investor and the founder to agree that we don't know what could happen a year from now or 2 years from now. So let's put some money into the company, allow you to start engaging with potential customers and so on. And then at some point down the road, an institutional investor will typically come in and negotiate with you, set the value for the company. And then folks like Rob or any of us here, their original investment will, what's called, convert at that time into ownership of the company. But typically in the early stage, you don't worry about that too much because it is so, as Rob mentioned, imprecise.
There's a great resource too. It's $100. It's called Class Rebel. And so basically what they do is they have like a fundraising boot camp. It's like 4 days, it's like 2 hours like in the evenings, but it just basically walks you through like a lot of these terms, like the tension between like an investor and a founder, what you should be looking for, if it is like a safe or a convertible note, like this is very much jargon now, but like what are those? What are the key mechanisms? Why are they important? And so that could be a good resource too, like if you ever are looking to raise capital, just to understand and demystify the fundraising process a little bit more.
So this is a bit of a general question, but generally speaking, when it comes to early stage companies, how have they typically, especially the successful ones, how have they typically gone about achieving product market fit?
Constant failure, constant micro failures, and constant iteration of what they've built. And you know, going back to the very first question, what makes a great founder? And I think there's some great conversation around that. Flexibility and the ability to pivot, small, even if it's small pivots, is instrumental in having these small failures and being able to change quickly. And it could be as simple as your message, how you're delivering your story, or it could be something more fundamental, like we found a completely different application of our technology that's better. But the ability to pivot in that way is how you really achieve product market fit.
Yeah, and I would also say never be married to your solution. Be married to the problem. Because if you're married to the solution, it's always kind of like, we're going to build it and they're going to come. It does not work like that, right? And so being obsessed with the problem and being okay that, like, you're going to go through a bunch of different solutions and it's going to change and, like, it's also okay. But those constant, like, little iterations and those constant, like, pivots are important. And it's almost like, yeah, the obsession with the problem. And that growth and, like, that curiosity mindset and willingness to, like, throw stuff at the wall and see if it sticks. And then just to kind of, like, pick yourself back up after it doesn't.
Being comfortable, not knowing things. Having infinite curiosity so that you can come to know them. Obsession with talking to hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of potential customers and finding ways to put them at the center of everything that you do so that you can create impact for them. And I think most importantly there is, as Danielle and Rob were mentioning, getting out of your own head and out of your own way and not allowing yourself to be too rigid around the direction that you're taking when the market that you are talking to and is willing to talk to you is screaming at you that there is a problem over here that needs to be solved for, that's so much more important, and so on. So just embracing that and just being willing to change when the change presents itself.
I'd say a lot of great companies die from uncoachable founders. It sounds really silly and trivial, but like being coachable and like listening to what's going on around you is like super important.
Awesome, thank you.
Thanks so much. Just had a question about the pitching part of the idea to the investors. So as Danielle said, the one who pitches the idea is basically, in a way, showing their baby to the world and hoping that they're not calling it ugly, right? So I was just wondering how much information about that baby would you say that the pitcher would have to give to the investor, right? Like, do you have to like cover the baby a little bit in the piece of cloth, or like show everything to the world, especially given the possibility of failing and getting rejected, right? And you don't want to like give out everything and then maybe the investor just doesn't like you, but would pick it up with someone else. This is probably a naive idea, but anyway, that's something that comes to my mind. I thought.
Yeah, I think that's a great question, and I'll answer them in reverse. First of all, extremely rare that you need to worry about a venture capitalist taking your idea and giving it to someone else. What is likely is that it is actually extremely unlikely that you're coming in and you're sharing an idea with a venture capitalist that they've not seen before. I've personally never seen that. And don't worry, invest in people who do. So they're not in the business of taking ideas and then executing them over here or over there. What I would instead suggest is to focus on having a really meaningful conversation with that person that's very human, right? And open and honest. Don't worry about all that other stuff. The second thing is around what should you prepare in your pitch and how much detail. It depends on the nature of the pitch that you're executing. So for example, maybe your intention is to have a first conversation where you're saying, I'm actually not raising money yet. I will be raising money maybe in 3 to 6 months, but I wanted to start a relationship here and give you some high level details about what I'm doing so I can see if you and I should go deeper when I'm ready. That kind of thing. And so in a scenario like that, if you have a conversation, you don't have to worry about whether or not you're getting a one or zero, pass or fail response. And then if you're actually pitching, the reality is, and this used to frustrate me so much when I was pitching, people would say to me, you need to be general but very specific at the same time. And that haunted me for so many years. It still haunts me, but you're not going to have a ton of time, and what you really want is for that person to have a conversation with you, so you need to condense it to 10 minutes tops, maybe. How do you take something super complex and condense it down to 10 minutes? That's what you're going to learn by talking to dozens and dozens and dozens of folks through that process, and that's what's most important in a formal pitch.
thanks for the panel discussion. I just have a kind of a general question. Just, you know, how are the views of investors changing when markets are starting to pull back? We're seeing a lot of, you know, general layoffs in the news, and what can companies do to navigate in these new waters?
Great question, Michael. So one of the things that we've seen in the market, and if anyone's been following the market, it's been a lot going on, and even with like this last weekend with Silicon Valley Bank, like there's lots of stuff that's happening. What I would say is we're really kind of going back to the basics and focusing on revenue and profitability. There's certain key success factors that will make your company kind of that next big thing. And so what I mean is, previously, and I'll like, you guys feel free to jump in on this, is like what we saw was a lot of companies were getting funded at very high valuations but might not have had a very sound business model in terms of how they were generating capital. And so you're seeing lots of money flow in and it's great, but then it also was becoming a very much like a grow at all costs. And so growing lots of people, growing lots of technical debt, and then it was kind of like, well, how are we generating revenue? What does this look like? What's our runway? And so what we've seen a lot, like, and especially as like the interest rates have gone out, because with 0%, almost 0% interest rates, it's like kind of this free money that's out of the ecosystem, is interest rates rising has really kind of forced a lot of companies and a lot of VCs to think about the way that they're prioritizing their investments. And so kind of this back to the basics mentality is what we've been kind of seeing at our end at 51.
I was just gonna say, I wouldn't worry about it too much. Just be prepared to, like Danielle was saying, flex on the valuation. Like we've seen valuations come down. Mm-hmm. Whenever there's macro instability and uncertainty, public markets or there's layoffs and valuations are just gonna come down, so don't get too stuck on that. But I wouldn't, other than that, I wouldn't be that worried about it. Like I would be singularly focused on what you're doing, the problem you're solving, mm-hmm. and just plow ahead.
So there's never a bad time to build a great company. And so for example, my partner, James Lockery, he started his company. And then a year later, the 2008 financial crisis happened. And we were burning $1 million a month. And we decided that we were going to be like Facebook and provide a completely free solution to millions and millions of small business owners. And it was an eyeballs game. And then suddenly we had to monetize, and that was really scary. We had to go through that transition and so on. So, and everything worked out with that company. It's about how you build your great company. And today there is a little bit less appreciation or aggression around spending tons and tons of money with very little traction. And as Danielle was mentioning, there's a lot more emphasis on fundamentals. Customers who are willing to pay today, even for a pilot or something like that, like those kinds of fundamentals are super important today.
My question is, what are the red flags in the founding team? Like, let's say there are a bunch of friends or relatives or something. Are there any red flags in the team? And if so, would you ask the team to restructure?
Does this work? Yeah. From our perspective, well, there's red flags with teams, generally, and we've referenced a few of them, but we don't see friends or family members as a red flag. I don't know if you guys would. But it can be a strength or a weakness, just like a family business or you go into business with your friends. Some people say don't do business with your friends or don't do business with your family. I'm in a family business, so. but it can lead to complete disaster. Like, there's just more risk. It can lead to complete disaster faster, or it can be completely magical. So we wouldn't view it as a red flag, just another factor to kind of consider.
There are several companies that we've invested in who have partner founding teams, and many of them are doing very, very well. So like Rob said, it's really not something that we would consider to be a risk. It's more about forgiving that detail, evaluating that founding team in the same way that you would evaluate anyone else.
Excellent. So does anybody have one more question that they've been dying to ask but haven't put up their hand? Right, I will take that as a the silence as a no. Well, I think in that case, we can wrap up here. If anybody would like to come and ask some kind of questions, maybe we can stick around for another 10 minutes or so. If anybody feels more comfortable in a small group, maybe we've got this room for another 10 minutes. But yeah, I think other than that, unless there's any parting thoughts, maybe we can go around and anything that one by one, if you guys have anything that you'd like to share as a closing thought, and then we can say goodbye.
Sure. Thanks, everybody, for spending time with us. This is a great place to build a company. Platform was mentioned earlier. It's just across the street. Great place to go to meet other potential founders or your next co-founder and gain access to venture capital, contacts, and all that kind of stuff. The vast majority of folks in this community are super friendly. Don't be worried about talking to someone who makes investment decisions. They're super friendly.
So what I was going to say is be general but specific. thank you everyone for coming out. What I would say is if you haven't thought about taking the risk of starting your own company, there's never a better time than now. There's a huge consolidation of talent that's happening. There's lots of great people out there. Also, if you have the opportunity to join a startup company, I would say join one. There's a ton of great startup companies in this ecosystem. I would say that's where kind of like I grit my teeth and like was in startup companies from like right after my undergrad, and like you learn so much. You learn so much about yourself, you learn so much about operating, you wear so many different hats. And it's really quite a wild time and a wild roller coaster, but great opportunities there too. So take the risk, maybe start a startup or join a startup.
Yeah, I really have nothing to add aside from those points. The other thing I would consider is partnering with an existing company. If you have, you don't want to take the risk or can't take the risk, partnering with an existing company in the space or something like that could be an option too. And, thank you for your time today.
Cool. Yeah, well, thank you everybody for coming, and thanks most of all to the panel, Rob Van Wielengen, Danielle Gifford, and Rick Bird. Your time's been incredibly valuable, so thank you.
Thank you.